people of Romania. He preferred an imaginary place where forelock-tugging villagers cross themselves in the foothills of the castle. Wolves howl, garlic flowers hang from every door, and the dark Germanic forest is full of things that go snap in the night. Fashionable late 19th century travel writers described the real Carpathian Mountains as a place where you leave the advanced West and enter the more primitive East. And where, as one of them put it, within this mountain rampart, the whole species of demons, witches and hobgoblins has taken refuge, driven from the rest of Europe by the wand of science. Stoker's novel was laced with ideas from traditional peasant stories, such as those about the Nosferatu, a Romanian word for vampire, told and retold from generation to generation.
To Victorian readers who lapped up romantic travellers' tales of Eastern Europe, the villages of the Carpathian Mountains were synonymous with folk tales, or superstitions as they called them, of the dead coming back to life, of wolves and werewolves, they're the ones who are hairy on the inside, of the eve of St. George's Day when all hell broke loose, and most of all, of the vampire or Nosferatu. Now these folk tales really grew out of the changing rhythms of agricultural life, the changing seasons of the year, age-old funerary customs, the fear of wolves. And the vampire of folklore was usually a ruddy-faced agricultural labourer with a serious breath problem, for fairly obvious reasons, who was as likely to come back to bite his sheep and cows as he was to molest his relatives. But what the undead actually did when they sank their teeth into their victims' necks seems to have confused everyone. In horror stories, and most of the movies based on them, the vampire uses his upper set of canines, sinks them into the victim's neck and leaves two telltale marks through which he drinks. But if he'd done that, he'd probably have got his upper set stuck in, and by the time he'd extricated them, the holes would have been very wide apart. In folklore, the vampire uses the upper and lower canines on one side of the mouth, captures a little piece of skin in between, and tears at the flesh like a rodent or a wolf. Now this skull of a wolf can make the process clear. Now these little teeth, the incisors, are the teeth which slice. But these bigger teeth, the upper and lower canines, are the teeth which tear. Very nasty indeed. So not only was the vampire of fiction promoted to the upper set of society, he only used his upper set of teeth as well. But whatever his modus operandi, he was known in this part of the world by two names, and two names only. Nosferatu, or vampire.
This is the real-life homeland of the 15th century Vlad Dracula, or Vlad the Impaler, whose portrait Stoker had seen on a late medieval pamphlet in the British Museum. His castle was deliberately built to be as difficult as possible for his enemies to reach. In Bram Stoker's version, Dracula is a count who lives in Transylvania. As a matter of historical fact, Vlad was a voivod, or prince, whose ruined castle lies 150 miles south, here in the remote mountains of Wallachia. In the novel, Stoker teased his readers with the admission, "I wasn't able to light on any map giving the exact locality of Castle Dracula." This, the real Castle Dracula, was only identified with certainty 25 years ago, in the early 1970s.
Thank you.
from being a satanic majesty, Vlad IV was an Orthodox Christian who earned his name Dracula, meaning son of the devil or son of the dragon, in a series of ferocious holy wars against the armies of the Turkish Ottoman Empire. On the walls of this glittering local monastery are portraits of Vlad's successors, the voivods of Wallachia, who continued the struggle against what were seen as the forces of darkness. Back in England, and back in the novel, after Dracula has arrived by ship, his contagion begins to spread like the plague. And the focus of the story shifts away from Whitby and the Count himself towards London, Highgate Cemetery, and the problem of how do you get rid of vampires, something with which Stoker seems to have become obsessed. The second half of the novel has various undead predators being staked through the heart with a piece of holy wood and turning back into happy corpses. In preparing this latter part of his novel, Bram Stoker was inspired by a real-life story he'd heard about the poet Dante Gabriel Rossetti. Now, Rossetti, whom Stoker knew, they'd been close neighbours, was in fact a nephew of Dr. John William Polidori, and he'd buried a little book of love poems in the coffin of his late wife Elizabeth Siddle here in Highgate Cemetery. A splendidly romantic gesture. Seven and a half years later, Rossetti changed his mind and decided to publish his poems. So he got Home Office permission to have the body exhumed and the book retrieved. One night, a fire was built by this graveside. The coffin was raised, the lid was opened, and Rossetti removed the book from the locks of golden hair in which he'd entwined it. Elizabeth Eleanor Siddle was described as perfectly preserved and still beautiful, with a kind of spectral halo about her as she came to light. For a moment or two, that is. When the book of poems was lifted, some of the red golden hair came away in Rossetti's hands, and the body began to decompose on contact with the air. But in Bram Stoker's hands, this story turned into something very different. It turned into a way of disposing of Lucy Westenra after she died and returned from the dead as a sexy, full-blooded vampire.
De profundis clamavi et te Domine, Domine exaudi vocem meam. Fiant horis tui intendendis et te patris in equitabri tui Domine qui omnium tum Domine. Et tu non sanam a me in corde. It looks perpetua, lucete. It is done.
Having brought together his research notes and jottings for the novel, which itself took the form of jottings and press cuttings and journal and diary entries, Bram Stoker decided at the very last minute to change the title from The Undead, or The Dead Undead, to Dracula. It was published in June 1897, price 6 shillings, in a stylish yellow and red binding, 3,000 copies. And then, 3 years later, in 1901, it was reissued as a sixpenny paperback in an abridged form, with the only illustration that Bram Stoker himself ever authorised. It's the military commander again, this time shinning down the walls of Castle Dracula, looking like an oversized bat with giant webbed feet. Bram Stoker went on to write 7 more novels and 3 works of non-fiction, but none of them came near Dracula in originality, success, or quality.
To protect the theatrical copyright of his novel by turning it into a play, Bram Stoker arranged a semi-dramatized reading on the stage of the Lyceum Theatre just before the book reached the bookshops.
The final scene.
The whole Dracula industry began here, with a show consisting of 5 acts and 47 scenes.
Dangerous to all of us and from all sides.
A Mr. Jones played Dracula, and it lasted nearly 5 hours. Here, finally, was a chance for Stoker to impress his boss with something he had achieved. But Henry Irving, who listened to the reading, stormed out at the end, declaring in a loud voice that the work was dreadful. His devoted servitor, who desperately wanted to please, must have been crushed.
Which has blighted all our lives.
The same year that Dracula was published, 1897, was the year that Sigmund Freud began his researches into psychoanalysis, and the novel's often been interpreted since then as a parable of repressed sexual desires. One Freudian has called it a kind of incestuous, necrophilious, oral, anal, sadistic, all-in wrestling match, which basically means that anything goes. Others have related it to the Oedipus complex, Dracula as daddy, or to a paranoia about liberated women who quite literally get put back in the box, or to a yearning to break every taboo in the business, especially taboos concerning blood, a case of stop it, I like it. One reason why the novel has remained so popular with adolescents, it's been argued, is because it's about sex from the neck up. Sex without guilt, without responsibility, without pregnancy. Sex which lasts forever. Sex which doesn't even need to be mentioned. Not exactly safe sex, but you can't have everything. Bram Stoker himself would have been absolutely amazed at all this analysis. A great fan of censorship, he once wrote, "The only emotions which in the long run lead to harm are those which arise from the sex impulse." To judge by Count Dracula, too much indulgence leads to hairy palms, a pallid complexion and very bloodshot eyes. It's likely that Stoker thought of his book as a simple adventure story about a gang of fine upstanding chaps who defend their womenfolk against the nasty Eastern Europeans who would make Britain part of their evil empire. But that, of course, doesn't begin to explain what's made Dracula so very, very popular.
Bram Stoker never lived to see the success of Dracula on stage or screen. After his death, Florence Stoker showed how sensible he'd been to try and protect the copyright when in 1922 she attempted to get some form of payment from a German film company for the first version of Dracula called Nosferatu, directed by Friedrich Wilhelm Murnau. The company had adapted the book, changing the names of the characters, but without asking anyone's permission. So Mrs. Stoker sued, and when the producers went out of business, she got a German court to rule that all copies of Nosferatu be destroyed. Fortunately for us, if not for her, one print survived in Germany. The film is now reckoned to be one of the classics of early cinema. Vampire Count has been transformed from a military commander into a bald-headed, emaciated creature of folklore with the ears of a bat and the fangs of a rat. He's the creature referred to by one critic as a penis with teeth. But it was Hollywood that projected Dracula onto a world stage and made the Count truly immortal.
Watch out! They may be hovering over you! Or you! Or you!
On Valentine's Day 1931, Universal Studios' Dracula, billed as the strangest love story of all, made a superstar of the well-fed, Hungarian-accented Bela Lugosi. He didn't resemble Bram Stoker's description at all, and he had difficulty speaking his lines in the English language, but he made the part.